I'm Vicki Schorsch, and I'm here with Bill Allen, our cameraman, to interview Randy Kusiak, a Vietnam War veteran. Mr. Kusiak, can you tell us, where were you born and when?
I was born August 16th, 1950, in Chicago, Illinois.
And brothers and sisters?
I have one brother, Jerry Kusiak, who's 79 years old. He's living in Mays Landing, New Jersey. My late sister passed away in 1983.
How about your mom and dad? What did they do?
My ma was a housewife. My dad was a printer, worked in Chicago. Oh, God, he passed away in the 80s, and my ma passed away in about 91, I'm pretty sure.
Now, did you grow up in Chicago?
I grew up in Chicago. I attended St. Genevieve's school on the Fullerton and Cicero Avenue, and then I eventually moved out to Jefferson Park area where I attended St. Constance School. Then I was a graduate of Weber High School for 4 years. And after Weber High School, I went to work at Delta Airlines at O'Hare Field, and I worked there for about 18 to about 19, almost 20, and then I entered the Army through the draft April of 1970. Okay, and I then proceeded to do basic training at Fort Polk, Louisiana, and then I did the AIT, Advanced Individual Training, for the infantry at Fort Polk, Louisiana.
Can you explain what that is, AIT?
AIT is basically your military occupational service, which you're going to enter, okay? And a lot of guys, what they'll do is, after basic, if they want to go to helicopter maintenance school, truck driving, clerk typist, artillery, they'll be sent to different special forts to do that. Since Fort Polk was an infantry training school, I was sent right down the road to the infantry training school where they specialize in different weapons, ground tactics, possibly learn how to read a map, compass, what type of, how to break down weapons, machine guns, grenade launchers, movement of fire, how to fire at night, how to see at night, and basically how to work in a heavy brush at night because they were prepping us for Vietnam.
How'd you feel about being drafted? It wasn't a very popular war at the time.
Well, here's the thing. I know this was always a little bugaboo about it, is the fact that they took a lot of guys from middle class, rural towns, guys that maybe didn't have enough money to go to college, and that was the pool they drew from. Now, the guys that did go to college, now if they want to go to college to study, that's fine. But then there's always guys that wanted to go to college because, well, the draft is around the corner. You know, I just don't feel like going there. So I think it kind of split the country because a lot of people that ended up in Vietnam were not sons of judges and lawyers and politicians. I mean, take a look at the sports world. I think I can only mention Rocky Blyer of the Pittsburgh Steelers was a guy who was in the infantry. Okay, a lot of the baseball players and football players and, you know, and basketball players, they all ended up in the National Guard. They got in. So, you know, I mean, they didn't want headlines of coming down of some guy who was a sports hero, and they get wounded and come back. So they, you know, they had a sort of like a little out, you know, that way. And I always kind of carried that feeling with me over the course of years. And I think that kind of split the country. You know, this is not like the World War II where we were attacked. I mean, we're going into an area that was set by policy of the State Department. The guys that ran the State Department at that time were McGeorge Bundy and Alan Dulles of the CIA. And, you know, it basically, you realize the fact when you're going into Vietnam, that country was invaded since the year 1000 by the you know, Chinese. You had the French there. You had the British there. You had the Japanese there. And then the French came back. And the French were not the best people to be the Republic because they basically exploited a country of rice and rubber. They had their own French currency. And I always thought that reason why, I guess the French got the Republic back in 1945 after the war. They wanted it back, and my feeling was it's like in a game of Risk. We needed the French in NATO. We needed their tank divisions. We needed their army. You had the British Army that was ground down. You had the American Army. My feeling was that was holding the Warsaw Pact, the Soviet divisions back in Eastern Germany. So we needed the French. So you make a deal, you know. Maybe President Truman makes a deal. Okay, we'll give you the Republic back of Vietnam as long as you join NATO. And it was, I think, a good book written by Stanley Karnow of Time Magazine, wrote the book, The History of Vietnam, and I kind of read it. I read it a second time and even a third time. And the first 100 and 150 pages is the history of Vietnam before, I think, we even arrived. So, you know, it was conquered by different countries, and it was exploited by different countries. And at that time, I think, since we were fighting Soviets in a Cold War, there was a lot of anti-communist. You had Senator Joseph McCarthy in 54 at that time. He was hunting out communist people and all that. And that kind of rolled into the, you know, State Department. And the thinking of is that if Vietnam fell, it would be a domino effect all the way down through Malaysia, through Indonesia, through all the way down to Australia. So when they got defeated at Dien Bien Phu in 1952, there was a vacuum. You had basically the country was split along, I think, the 38th parallel. I'm not too sure about the parallels, but I think it's the 38th. And the South was then composed of Buddhists and Catholics. The North was run in a communist form. And then, of course, they had the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution. And then the Johnson put in the Marines in 64. And then it escalated from there.
How did you feel when you were drafted? Was it, you said 1970?
1970.
Did you feel like you had a pretty good understanding of what was going on there at the time?
Well, what I saw on TV, okay, and you see it on TV and you read it in the papers, either the Chicago Tribune or so happens you might get other paper publications. I had a funny feeling that this thing would kind of spiral, start in a spiral effect. And I think, what was the quote? I think General Douglas MacArthur says, never get a war, getting involved in a war in Southeast Asia. And I kind of read one of his quotes because he was the governor general of the Philippines before the war. And he mentioned it's just, there's too many tribes and everything there. I think I felt that I'm not sure if I thought I was going to get involved in it, but I knew that if I was going to get drafted, my dad was served in World War II in the Pacific, in the Navy. And I just thought that it was, if my number was up and if I got drafted, I go. There's no complaints because I'm carrying my father's legacy. You know, it was that, you know, it was that feeling that my father served, my uncle served as bomber gunners in the 8th Army Air Force over Germany in World War II. I had cousins that served in World War II, and I had another cousin that served in Korea. So I felt that if it's my time, it's my time. You know, I wasn't the guy that, yeah, let's go, let's get them. I wasn't the guy to go, I'm going to burn my draft card because I would never do that, mm-hmm. You know. But I thought if my time was to go, my time was to serve, you know.
And you, when you arrived in Vietnam, tell me a little bit about what that was like when you first got there.
When I first got there, the C-130 landed. over at down, I think it was at Cameron Bay, and the door opened up, the back door opened up, and then I felt the oppressive heat. Okay. And I walked out there and I see a lot of GIs moving around, cargo being moved on the ramp to and from. And all of a sudden, the first thing I saw is these people about 4'8", all with their straw hats. They were probably hired to work at the airport, you know, and contracted out by the Defense Department. And that's my first indication when I saw them in their little straw, you know, triangular type hats. And that was the first, you know, time I says, they're not that big.
That's right. So when you arrived there, did you come with a whole load of other GIs?
A whole load of other GIs, but all mixed up. When you get to a formation, a holding area, you end up getting your paperwork processed. And then you go to an area, and this was really funny. We were in a formation, and it was like about 4 days we were there getting shots, getting our work process. And then they lined us up in certain columns, and they would say, you're going to the 4th Infantry Division, you're going to the Big Red 1, you're going to the Air Cav, and then our group, it says, you're going to the 101st Airborne Division. And I go, oh my God, I says, I'm kind of a little historian. I says, oh, that's Bastogne. I says, that's World War II. Those guys were surrounded. They jumped into D-Day. I says, I'm not airborne. I says, even though I'm gonna be on a helicopter, I says, even though you have the Screaming Eagle patch on your shoulder and you're supposed to be proud of it, I says, I never jumped on it. There's no jumping. I says, it's air mobile. I says, but, you know, is this a gung-ho division? You know, so. I was sent from there up to Fubai, and at Fubai, I was stationed at Fubai for a few days, and then at Fubai, you're in a brigade headquarters, and you're busted down to battalion headquarters, and at battalion, you're sent to your company headquarters. And then I was in the rear in Fubai, waiting for my orders to go out into the field.
And how was your first experience? Well, first of all, how did you acclimate to being there with the platoon you were with?
The platoon was out in the field.
Okay.
Okay. So whoever was in the rear was be a top sergeant or sergeant. What they do is you're new. You don't know how you're going to be carrying everything on your back called the rucksack. So you get usually a guy there who's a supply sergeant, says you need this, you need that, you need this, you need canteens, you need your bedroll, you need how much ammunition you're going to carry, you're going to need certain type of gear to carry around your belt, you'd be at pistol belts. So you try it on, okay, and you see, and you don't realize how much weight you're carrying. And the minimum weight is 50, and you're carrying 65, 70 pounds. And well, back in Fort Polk, Louisiana, you're basically not working with a rucksack. You're working with, when you go out in the field, you're gonna come back on a truck and eat chow in a mess hall. So you're not prepped to carry this, even though you're physically fit and you did all the basic training and the running. You're not set up at that time to carry that type of weight. And whoa, you get it on and you gotta rebalance yourself. And then of course, when you get on the helicopter, you were sent out, and my first location was Firebase Brick. Okay, and Firebase Brick was very scary. It was a firebase with artillery on it, and surrounded by barbed wire and an infantry bunkers that are in front of the artillery to protect the artillery and the hill. And that, when I first got there in the afternoon, it was the monsoon season of October, I think, started, and it was foggy, it was misty, dark, dreary, and there was no roads into the fireplace. Everything was supplied by helicopter. And that's kind of scary because, you know, you don't have a road where you can get trucks in. And everything is supplied by a helicopter, and you think, you look up there, and if there's ever something that comes out, and the tree line was close. It wasn't 200 yards back. The tree line was like 50 yards from the wire. And anybody could be in that tree line, and they could set up something that you can't see. And if a helicopter comes in to resupply, they could knock that helicopter down. And then, you know, cause a lot of havoc. So I was at Firebase Brickwood. Then I met Jim Zwit. He was from the south side of Chicago. I was from the north side of Chicago. So immediately it was a Cub Sox situation. And being down here, being interviewed on the south side, we know where your loyalty lies. I'm the enemy from the north side, you know what I mean? Cubby blue. But
so does that mean you guys got along or you didn't?
Oh, we hit it off. He always would dig about it, you know, about the Sox versus the Cubs and everything like that. And he was a South Sider, and of course I was a North Sider. And you know, he would try to get the best of me, you know, and he would razz me, you know, and he would try to get under my skin. And I know he's trying to get under my skin, so I knew exactly, you know. I says, how do I play this guy? You know what I mean? How do I handle him? You know, but he took me into the platoon as a brother, you know, and I couldn't ask for anything more, you know, and we hit it off good, you know, except if there's a couple of times I screwed up. I was on air mattresses were in short supply.
Where are we at?
We're at, I was with Jim Zwit, okay. We were at, he introduced me to the guys in the platoon, okay. And I got a nickname of Sylvester. So I was called somehow en route. Some guy said, you're Sylvester or something like that. So when I got into the platoon, you know, my real name was Randall Kusiak or Randy. And, so if I gave him that name, it says maybe those guys will forget about, you know, they'll ask me six times, you know, before I, you know, they have 30 guys that you're introduced to. So I says, it's Sylvester. Mm-hmm. Well, I says, but my real name is Randall or Randy. And I says, no, you're Sylvester. I got stuck with it. Okay. I couldn't get rid of it. I got tired. So from then on, it wasn't Randall or Randy, it was Sylvester. Okay, so that's how that kind of nickname stuck.
Now, I know you said you met Jim, a fellow Chicagoan, but how was it getting acclimated with a variety of other guys from all over the country?
Well, the guys from all over the country, big man, Bob Gervais, he's from New York City, so we kind of connected on that because him being from a big city. And then I started meeting guys from small towns, a lot in the South, Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, Ohio, Kentucky, Alabama, South Carolina, North Carolina, Upper Michigan, not even Michigan, but Upper Peninsula Michigan. A lot of guys were from small towns. You know, a lot of guys weren't going to college. They were there. Some of there maybe were there that I knew that enlisted. And then some of them, you know, a lot of them got drafted and they were going to serve their time in Vietnam. And I got along with everybody. Basically, we didn't have anybody in our platoon that was obnoxious or you know, cause a problem. Because we know when we were there, okay, we got to stick together. We can't fight with each other. You know, there's no such thing as a rivalry, okay? We got a one for all and all for one. And the guys from the small towns, I learned, you know, there are guys from hardware stores that worked in hardware stores. Some guys worked as farmers. Some guys worked as cattle ranchers. We had a couple guys from the West Coast, Richard Padilla. He was from California, L.A., you know. And there was Jack Wright that's not here. He was from Oroville, California. And let's see, I had Sergeant Phil. He was from, I think he was from Wisconsin. But then in the, later on, I think he worked in Oklahoma and he's back in Minnesota. So he was my squad leader, Sergeant Paul Thill. And then I met our Lieutenant Baker at that time. He was our LT. And he looked regular Army all the way. Looks like he was going to make a career out of that. He was our first lieutenant before, later on, Lieutenant Humphreys came in and he became my primary lieutenant later on. In the battle, okay. So, but all the guys I try to learn what their customs were, and you know, we didn't really talk about the view of the war. We didn't really talk about politics. We talked about sports. We talked about hometown. We weren't trying to get a job at the State Department or something. You know.
What's a typical day like in Vietnam?
Well, typical day in Vietnam, trying to remember, is, of course, you know, usually about 6:30 in the morning, you're usually up. Some guys will end up going on a detail, and you hit, if you're not going to go, if you're on a fire base, you're going to probably be going on up to the mess hall to eat breakfast early in the morning. You come back, and you'll basically take care of your weapons, and you take care of your position, and you'll end up being in a bunker, and sometimes you'll write letters home, okay? You may listen, if you have a cassette player, you'll listen to maybe somebody sent cassettes from home, or then you'll turn on and somebody will send you some cassettes about some, you know, new music that's coming out of the States, and you'll play the music. And then you get sometimes hooked with detail. You'll be filling sandbags. There's times where you'll be entering, you're in charge of sanitation, okay? That's the only way I can say it. That's about the only way, clean way I can say it, you know?
That's probably a job nobody wanted.
Okay? That's a job no one wanted, okay? You know, it was waste burning. But then at night, then it becomes the evening. It comes that, you know, sometimes you may want to take a little rest in the evening after chow, because you may be pulling bunker guard duty at night. You may have a 8 to 10 watch, and then you pass the watch to the other guy, and then you're out looking. You're not in a bunker. You could be out on a trench, and you're out on there, and you're looking through what you call as a starlight scope, which it takes the light from the stars, magnifies it in your eyesight, in your optic, and then you could see. Now, it was kind of fuzzy to see through at that time. They're not as good as they are today, the night scopes. I mean, at that time, they were kind of primitive, but they were big. And you would usually have to scan the perimeter line, the Constantina wire, barbed wire, and then you would make sure there would be no movement. Now, every once in a while, someone would hit a flare that they would pop the flare, send a flare up, and it had a parachute, and it would hover for a minute or two over your position or by the wire. But the scary part about that is that when it starts coming down, before it lands, it gives off a lot of shadows, and you think that there's movement out there. So you got to kind of keep your eyesight, you know, peeled, that it's a shadow, because light's coming down and there's shadows, and it gives like a false movement. So basically, and then of course the next day you start again, and then sometimes you're doing weapons cleaning, and sometimes the lieutenant or the sergeant will say, okay, let's go down to a range down here and we'll practice weapons training. All right, so we'll go to a range outside the barbed wire, fire in a targeted area, and see how we do on our scores.
How was it when you were out in the field, or not on the fire base? What's a day like that?
Day like that is, it's rough. It's not only the fact, it's physically rough. Because it's not like walking on a flat plane. You're up and down. You have vines that, when you get into a tight area, they grab onto your ruck. I call them wait a minute vines, because you can get pulled and wait a minute, okay? Pulled your ruck. The vines are thick, okay? I don't think we were in triple canopy. I call it maybe double canopy. Triple canopy is really high trees, and then there's another canopy. I think we're more like in double. And you're tripping over roots, okay? You're moving on, and branches are always against your forearms. And of course, leeches would drop off onto those things, and then you don't know about it, and they'll get under your, and before you know it, when you're sitting down resting, then you'll find out, what the heck's going on? You know, why am I bleeding? Well, the leech is sucking the blood out of your forearm, and it's getting bigger. You know, it's a little thing, and all of a sudden, the more blood he sucks, the bigger he gets. And it's kind of a rubbery looking worm. That's basically it. You get those, you have, you're always wet. If you're not wet, you could be in a dry season and you're wet because you're sweating all the time, humidity. In the monsoon season, it just rains. And just rains, and it just and it's not a heavy rain. To me, there are some heavy rains, and then there's sometimes it lets up, and then there's a light misty rain, and then it'll start the heavy rain, and then it'll go back to the light rain. So it was hard to keep dry. You know, it was very hard to keep dry. We built little hooches where we take ponchos, we snap them together. I would say they were like 6 feet by 6 feet square. And then if you snap another one together and you put plastic over the seam, and each poncho had eye loops on the edges. And then we always would use shoestring attached to the eye loops. And then we would tie it off to the little branches and trees. And it would be the opening to get in, and the ponchos would be about this far off the ground, I would say, from starting, and then they would go up, and they would come down, and you didn't want them too high because you didn't want a lot of water in. You kind of keep them tight to the ground. You're not going to stand up in them. You could sit up in them. That's as much as you can. You put your two air mattresses side by side, and you basically bunked on the trail or off the trail, and you always put palm leaves on the ground. You cut palm leaves because you don't want to sit on the mud. So you get a bunch of palm leaves, put it on the ground, you put a poncho on there, and that is basically your foundation. And then two other ponchos would go up, and those ponchos would be tied to a tree, and then you would have a stake on each side that you would have support to keep the triangular shape of the tent, or your hooch, we used to call it. So that's where you would be out there during the course, sleeping in the evening and staying dry during the monsoons. Now, of course, when they tell you it's time to move out, you break it all down, you roll it all up, you put it on your rucksack, you get your ruck, you eat chow, and then you start moving out. Okay, and to the next position, I don't know.
You know. Now tell me what happened in April of 1971.
April 15th, 1971, we were supposed to go up there and claim a couple bodies. And about 7 o'clock at night, we were 3rd platoon in the rear, and we were supposed to be walking the point platoon. And I remember we were walking up this hill, and I saw all these big, huge trees, and they were destroyed, something that you see destruction in the jungle, but these were big, humongous trees that were destroyed. And we had to kind of climb over it, okay? And I says, the only reason they destroyed these trees is probably a B-52 bomb strike. Now, why would they bring in a B-52 bomb strike? Is because there's got to be a concentration of enemy in the area. And did we scare them away? Maybe not. Because, like I says, they've been digging bunkers since the year 1000, tunnels, because they had incursions, so they know the area. And my feeling is we get into that area, and then contact started, I think, around 7 o'clock, 7:05, and I saw Jim Zwitt run right past me with the gun. And I moved my way slowly up there, and there was a lot of fire, taking fire, and apparently then we heard we're taking fire from basically different sides, from flanks. So then anyway, I heard that we had some casualties up front and we needed some guys to go up there and get these casualties and get them back. So I went up there and there was Zwitt, he was hurt. Someone probably pulled Zwitt back from contact farther, and I grabbed Jim Zwitt, pulled him over the log. I got him to like the center of our area where it was kind of secure enough. And, you know, he was in bad shape. There was a couple other guys in bad shape. And we waited. I had to go back to a position to secure my position. And I would look around and make sure. And then the helicopter come in. And then they drop what you call this jungle penetrator. It's an arm that sticks out of the helicopter, a boom, with a cable. And the cable flips out to like 3 seats, okay? And I happened to grab Jim. I got him on the jungle penetrator. And then I hook a cable around his back to hold him on because you just can't, you know? And of course, he was very wary. He had blood all over. And at that time, while the helicopter was hovering, from out on one of the flanks, you could see a trail of smoke come out, and there was a rocket fired, an RPG rocket fired, and it bounced off the skid of the helicopter. There was now the helicopter's up about, I'd say 40 feet, maybe 50 feet, and it hit that skid. And it bounced off and blew up in the trees. And then, of course, everybody opened up and returned fire on whoever fired that round, that RPG. And while Zwitt was getting cabled up, he only got cabled up halfway. And then that helicopter could not stay there any longer because he figured the next one, they're going to get him. So he took off with Jim with about maybe 30 feet of cable slack on him. And rode him through the trees and out, but they got him out. In the meantime, we secured the position. That night, we had the United States Naval aircraft in on us, helping us. We had the United States Marine aircraft on all over us. We had the United States Air Force, I think, was out there. Dropping ordnance around our position. The LT was, Lieutenant Humphreys was calling in the grid coordinates. And we had Army Cobras. And we all night long, we had illumination that was fired from the fire base. So we had a lighted area to see if they were encroaching in our position. We would take harassment fire occasionally. And then, of course, there was no sleep. And there was no way to dig foxholes. You just had to basically secure yourself behind some blown out trees or whatever it was. Nobody could take an entrenching tool and say, oh, I'm going to dig a foxhole right now and stuff like that. And the ground was so hard and rooted to begin with that you couldn't really get a shovel into the ground in that area. So you just had to roll logs around you had to make your own little bunker and fighting area. That's what I did, you know. And the next morning, if I recall, I was tired, weary. There wasn't any contact at that time. And eventually later on, I think we got a call from Tactical Operations Command, from the colonel, that you have so many, carry your dead and your wounded. Whatever wounded was, I don't know how many wounded got out on the helicopter, but the next day, medevacs landed. I think Jim was the last guy out, to tell you the truth. I'm not, you know, sure, but I think he was the last guy out. And the next morning, there was a medevacs come in, and took some other wounded out, okay? And then they took whatever dead they were out that they could, and whatever dead was left, the colonel said, it's time, you have to get off the hill. Because you have to get off the hill at a certain time, we have a big, huge B-52 strike coming in, and we want to take out the hill. So it was very hard when you're carrying, you know, your fellow GIs out, because you're not carrying them on flat. You have stretchers, and you have to go up and down the mountains and everything, and we had to find a certain meeting point. I think we had to move maybe 2,000 meters off the area, maybe 3,000 meters, because when the B-52s come in, you know, they just boom, boom. They're not like today where you can laser guide something in. You know, they're dropping dummy iron bombs, and if they're not on a target, you could be the target. Right. You know, so. And then I can remember I think I was breaking brush to find a hill that we were supposed to get the helicopters and get us out of there. And that's about the last time I can recall is that ride back in when we got in there. I had two guardian angels. I did not get a scratch on me. I mean, there's guys that got hurt, there are guys that got wounded. I did not get a scratch on me. I was so lucky.
That's
right. I mean, I had two guardian angels. Not one, two. And then when I found out, when I got back to the rear, I heard he was in a hospital, and then he went from the, Da Nang Hospital, he went to Da Nang, and then he went to Tokyo, and then he ended up at Great Lakes Hospital back in Chicago, up in the North Shore area, recuperating, where then my mom and dad went to see him because they didn't know what my job was. But Jim's mother contacted my mother on the north side. She was on Jim's mother was on the south side. And my mother went. In fact, there's a picture of Jim, my mother, and I when he was recouping. He was about 110 pounds, you know. And then she wanted to ask questions, what's going on? Because I always wrote in letters back home, oh, I'm doing okay. You know, I never said I was in the field, you know what I mean? I wrote letters to my brother saying I was in the field, you know, this is not going so good, you know. But my mom, I always tried to cover that thing, you know. And then, of course, when I ended up leaving Vietnam, I got home and I got at O'Hare Field. And I ended up, all my family was around me. It was great. My mom hugged me. She was in tears. I remember that. My sister there, brother there, brother-in-law, sister-in-law there, you know, and nephews. And we took a nice slow ride home through the airport. I did not have any feedback from anybody at O'Hare Field. Okay, because we were walking in groups and, you know, I didn't. But it was so strange that when you come back into the real world that, you know, it was just a different, you're like you were in a twilight zone for a year, you know. And, you know, you can, the politics involved in it, you know, after years. That's why I always think that what Jim does teaches the kids history, hopefully never to repeat itself. You know,
you like to think that.
I'm trying to think positive. You know what I mean?
Yeah. How long after April of 71 was it before you came home?
After April 71, when I came home, I spent it was April. I spent from April to October, or September, out there in the field. Okay, now we had other little contacts with other little harassment fire, VC. We didn't ever have any heavy NVA contact. I I was changing lieutenants every other month. Like there would be a different lieutenant in every other month. I was getting what you call down to maybe about 30 days, okay? And 30 days, it was September, they pulled me out of the field, and I got put on bunker guard duty over at Fubai. and I spent my 20 days there as going up and making sure the guys are awake in the morning and passing out coffee and donuts and then sitting in a fighting position and making sure that I did my job. And then about my time was up sometime around October, I got in. I remember getting on the airplane, and I remember as we're leaving, I was leaving Cameron Bay, or Long Bin, I think it was Long Bin Air Base. And I sat down in the seat and the wheels took off. They lifted off the ground. A lot of guys were yelling and screaming, hooping and hollering, and I didn't blame them. I just sat back in my chair and, you know, went like this, and I went to sleep. I just said, it's over. Plane, please don't crash. And when we stopped in Yokota to refuel, and then from Yokota, we got to Alaska. I think it was Anchorage, Alaska was our drop-off point. And when I got to Anchorage, Alaska, they opened up that door and I walked down on the stairs and walked down. It was like 50 degrees and I got down on the tarmac on my knees and I kissed it. I says, cool, dry weather. Oh my God, is this great? This is a gift from heaven. Then I ended up going to Fort Washington, staying there, Fort Lewis, Washington. And then from there, I took the flight to Chicago at O'Hara Field where I met my family. And then I had another four or five months I had to serve at Fort Hood, Texas in an armored unit before I finally got released from the United States Army. And then I came home, and I remember when I was, it was like, first of all, when I got out of the Army, I came home. I remember the first week I was there, I went out and I did a lot of drinking and I did a lot of girl chasing, okay? I mean, I'm home, I'm back at 5304 North Mason Avenue in Chicago, Jefferson Park, Illinois. It's beautiful, nice little tree-lined street of red bungalows, and you know? Yes, you do know it well. And then after a Sunday night, it was Monday morning of the following week, I was home. And it was 7 o'clock in the morning, I get a tap on my side of my head. It's my father. He says, I gave you your week. It's time now to report back to work. Okay? He wouldn't let me, you know, because he was a WW2 guy. Okay? He says, you had your week of fun. Now it's time to get serious. So I went back to work for the airlines.
Was it difficult to transition back to civilian life?
Well, you know what's funny? The thing about it is guys that I thought that were guys that I thought I were friends with in high school and grade school from around the area, the guys that some of the guys didn't go, never sent me a letter. You know, never said, how you doing out there? It was weird. When I got back in there, they says, oh, okay, what are you doing tonight? It's not like, you know, I mean, so I sort of like says, okay, that's over. That's our relationship is kind of over with this. You know, I mean, if you didn't even want to ask about what went on, you know, that's fine. I didn't want to tell them any war stories. I didn't want to embellish anything. You know what I mean? I was not a hero. I was just doing my job. The country called me for, okay? And I wanted to get back with my life, and I wanted to get back to work. Mm-hmm. I wanted to make some money and buy a car and find a nice girl, eventually, hopefully, to marry, which I did.
Yeah, tell me about that.
Well, I found my my lovely wife, Julie. I found her, we were at a dance club out in River Grove, Illinois, and I remember that I was, we talked a little bit at the dance club. It was called the Thirsty Whale out on.
I've been there.
You've been?
I'm a Northwest Sider myself, yeah.
Okay, you know it, all right?
You said River Grove, I thought that's what it was.
Okay, and what we did was we were there. I saw her pass by. She had She had that hair that woman are in a commercial. You know how they flip it up when they're selling shampoo commercials? It was thick and silky, you know, and beautiful eyes, just gorgeous eyes. And what happened, I have to hold up a second because she passed away October.
I'm sorry.
We had 42 years of a good marriage. And loyal, trustworthy, loving. She gave me 4 boys. When I met her at Thirsty Whale, I remember she was, we were walking out to the parking lot. No, we were walking. I says, listen, she says, I'm going up to this called the Hyatt Hotel. And at that time, they had what you call is midnight breakfasts. And the Hyatt Hotel is one of those brand new hotels at first where the elevators were going, they go up into the ceiling. It was something like on a Space Odyssey. It was brand new type of architecture. It wasn't like those old hotels. And I remember going in there and go, wow, this is a great place. You know, they got ivy hanging from here and the ceiling is open. You can see the stars. And I says, I ain't gonna see her here. And sure enough, she was there sitting there with her 3 girlfriends. They were having breakfast in the lobby area. So I sat down, we started talking, and then we kind of hit it off, and I says, can I see you next week and get your phone number? She says, yeah. So I says, how do I impress this girl? So as we were walking out to the parking lot, I was with another guy there that night. They were walking like kind of with me, and then I turned. Now I had a 67 Chevy with a dent in the thing, okay? That's what I had, okay? It was a 67 Chevy. And it was light blue, kind of beat up. And I remember walking, and I saw this convertible Mercedes-Benz parked in one of the spots close to me. So I pretended I was fumbling for my keys, and then we went over there. And as the girls were walking by, you could hear them whisper, ooh, look at that little sports car he's getting into. So I waited till they went out of eyesight, and then I told my friend, okay, let's get in my 67 Chevy. So when I picked her up the next week, she said, what happened to that little sports car, okay? That funny, that nice-looking little sports car. You go, well, I'm sorry. I says, I did pull one on you. I wanted to impress you. She says, well, that's okay. And then, we only went out for a month before I asked her to marry me. And we got married. And I was working as an iron worker, and I got laid off. And I remember I could sit at the union hall and wait for a job. And this was around Christmas time. Or I can go downtown and see what's around downtown. And I ended up at the Board of Trade, okay? And I somehow got in contact with some people at the Board of Trade. They had a little exchange open up called the Chicago Board Options Exchange. So, you know, they needed runners. Okay, and I says, yeah, while I wait to go back to work as an iron worker, I will get a job as a runner. I won't take unemployment at that time. I says, I'll work. You know, I'll work here until they call me, a union calls me back or a job site calls me back. Well, guess what? I was only making $575 a month. I went from $7 an hour at that time back in 1973, which was good money as an apprentice iron worker. And you can move up to $20 and $30 an hour at that time to $525 a month as a runner on the Chicago Board Options Exchange for a firm called H.S. Kipnis & Company. Well, I eventually went from 5 months later, they promoted me, and I still didn't get any work. 5 months, they promoted me to clerk. Okay. And then after that, 6 months later, I got an opening where the higher-ups at Kipnis says, we're going to put a badge on you, and you're going to become a member. You're going to trade. You're going to be a trader representing our orders in the crowd. So then I was working for H.S. Kipnis & Company as a trader in the options trading pit on the CBOE until I got a chance. Well, then all of a sudden, the firm was sold. I didn't have the badge anymore. So I had to rent a badge. You could rent memberships. So I rented a membership. Eventually, I bought a little membership that was good for 10 years. They incorporated a Midwest Stock Exchange into the CBOE, and I had a membership for 10 years. So we saved our money like mad. And then about 2 years later or 3 years later, I bought the Chicago Board Options Exchange membership. And then eventually later on, I rolled that in to the Board of Trade membership, which I was on the trading floor for 25 years. And then the computers took it over. I had to go, and I couldn't, and I says, I'm gonna be in the financial business. I says, I got, you know, 1 year, you know, of junior college at night. I says, this ain't gonna cut it. I says, I'm competing against boys from MIT and Stanford University. They're writing computer code. They're not even talking about a stock analyst. They're writing computer code to artificially buy stocks and options automatically through the computer. I can't compete with these guys. So I ended up getting a commercial driver's license as a truck driver, and I had 10 years where I did that for 10 years, and then eventually later on I delivered some freight down to a place called Flagler Beach in Florida. They did have a machine tool shop down there, and it was the plant was no more than a mile away from the ocean. And this was in 2005. Yeah, 2005. And then I went across the bridge on the intercoastal, and there's this little town called Flagler Beach, and there's a town called Palm Coast. And I called up the wife in 2005. I says, you know what? I says, honey, I says, let's sell our house in Arlington Heights, where I lived for 27 years. And I says, it's time to pull the plug on Illinois. And I says, and she says, okay. And I bought a place down there, and we moved the whole family down there. And that's where I'm at right now, Palm Coast, Florida. Nice. It's a very nice community, okay? It's four miles from the ocean, and a lot of beautiful biking trails and hiking trails, and it's really nice. It's 35 miles north of Daytona Beach and 25 miles south of St. Augustine. Yeah, a lot of people don't know about it.
Before we wrap up, is there anything what would you say you'd like future generations to kind of know about the Vietnam War, wartime service, or American soldiers?
Well, I think the American soldier is today, I think the American soldier is more well-trained, and it's more high-tech. And I think not just for soldiers, I think for the woman, because we do need a woman in the military. And we got to give them that chance, because they've got brains. And they've got gumption, and they could handle. And I'm not saying they should be in the infantry, because that's another question for debate. Because take a look at a man versus woman, his upper body strength, okay? But they could fly helicopters, they could fly jets. And I always would tell, I says, you know, for girls, if you have a chance, don't, you know, think that, you know, there's a good computer programmers. I mean, they're. Besides just nurses, I said, you can do anything. So I would, and not only that, but the historical perspective of getting involved in foreign incursions, I'd be very leery unless you have the backing of the people that want you there.
Yeah.
That's the biggest thing, okay? Mm-hmm. Not for some philosophy. I mean, you have to have the backing of the people. Because I noticed that in Vietnam, when we were there, if we ever go off base and into a little city, just on an R&R, I would look around and I would see some of these Vietnamese kids on motorbikes. They're 18, 19, 20 years old. How come they're not in? Okay, why are we in? You know, you can always ask that question of why we were there. I think it was basically the big politics at the time of the communists versus anti-communists, the incursion, the French were gone, there was a vacuum, South Vietnam was split, you had that. So,
yeah.
So.
Well, okay. Thanks so much for your time, and thanks for sharing your story.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thanks.